VentureCast.
Make summer more delicious with Whole Foods Market, where there's something for every adventure. Get ready for road trips with wallet-happy snacks, sparkling waters, and sports drinks from 365 by Whole Foods Market. Taking a staycation? Make it count with wild-caught fresh sockeye salmon, beef kebabs, and sirloin steaks for the grill, plus sweet and juicy summer fruit like sugar-kissed melons and organic cantaloupes. Don't forget fruit-filled pies for dessert. Summer your way with Whole Foods Market.
This episode is brought to you by KPMG. At KPMG, innovation is the go-to state of mind. Their visionary thinkers and advanced technology help you see beyond the now, uncover new insights, and turn them into opportunities. KPMG can help you leverage the value of data and drive transformational outcomes through innovation. To explore their thinking, go to kpmg.us.
There's a change happening in the way we live, the way we work, the way we spend our money and make our decisions. We are evolving to be more conscious in our actions in a way that serves the world and makes it a better place. Welcome to The Ethical Evolution. The Ethical Evolution podcast is brought to you by Ethical Change Agency. I'm Bindi, I'm the founder, and my mission is to help ethical entrepreneurs and holistic healers to find their voice through spiritual coaching and podcasting. I'm honored to bring you the stories of those who create change through healing, kindness, innovation, purpose, and spirit. Understanding that to create collective change, we need to be the change. It all begins with us. In late 2020, Jon Katz went through a horrendous breakup. The breakup, compounded with the weight of an unstable childhood, decades of poor decision-making, poor relationship choices, and poor habits, left him obese, anxious, depressed, and suicidal at the age of 34. That was 2 years ago. Since then, he has turned his life around in every conceivable way, and now coaches others on how to step back from the path of negativity, poor health, hopelessness, worthlessness, fear, and suicide. Since getting healthy, he has established a citywide food rescue program in New York City that currently feeds thousands of families a week with edible but unsaleable food donations that would otherwise be thrown out. This episode discusses suicide and suicidal ideation, which some people might find disturbing. If you or someone you know is impacted, help is available. Speak to someone today. Here in Australia, Lifeline is available 24 hours a day on 13 11 14. Welcome, Jon, to The Ethical Evolution.
Pleasure to be here. Thank you for having us.
Now, for those who don't know who you are, Jon, can you go ahead and tell us who you are and what you do?
Absolutely. I am a personal development coach based in New York City. I'm an online coach, so I work with folks across the country and actually around the world. I've had some international clients. I come initially from a place of deep internal darkness, and in healing those wounds within, I've been able to externalize the power of healing to others, and I'm here to spread the message of positivity with you and with everyone joining us today, because everything that is been given us in a negative sense has actually provided us to us in a positive sense, and I hope we can get into further depth in that in a sec.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, you've had a pretty remarkable life thus far. Do you want to tell us a bit about some of your story and the things that have occurred in your life and led you to where you are?
Absolutely. I mean, the defining feature of my life, all of our lives, is our pain, right? Yeah. It's the thing that we hold closest to us before we're able to heal it. And it's that thing that unites us as a species. I mean, I say this all the time, that pain is not a differentiator. It's actually a commonality between us. And it's those of us that are willing to be open about our pain and our trauma and healing that are able to connect with others. So my pain came from unresolved pain from my folks. Both of my folks experienced a fair bit of trauma in their own young lives. Unlike most people of their age, they're in their 70s now, they didn't really have an outlet to process it. The information that we have in today's contemporary society wasn't really around. So they import a lot of that to the relationship and then ultimately in raising me. And I didn't do myself any favors. You know, I'm not a victim of anything or anyone or any act except my own thoughts and actions and in response to my stimuli. And the key thing to know is that I just did what was expected of me. It's expected of us, at least in the dominant global culture, to use drugs, to drink alcohol, to have as much promiscuous hookups as many promiscuous hookups as possible, to eat as much as possible, and to do essentially what makes us feel good in the moment. And that's a very painful, those are very painful acts. I mean, those acts included womanizing and engaging in a lot of real degenerate activity around drug use and partying and hooking up, a lot of overeating, a lot of pleasure seeking, a lot of denial of self, a lot of denial of what I'd been through, a lot of denial of others and what they needed from me in my relationships. It was just overall an extremely negative way of being and led me to a very dark place. You know, you can't engage in negative acts and not be driven to a negative place. And I went through a breakup a few years ago, and following the breakup, I was just at my wit's end, and I went headfirst into the pit of negativity. All of the negative acts I engaged in as an adolescent, post-adolescent, college, and after, in relationships and out, just went to the nth degree, and it drove me to a very, very dark place. I mean, I had done so much negativity that I was actually considering killing myself. And That was my rock bottom, to use addict's parlance. And for me, it was just me at the deepest, darkest point of my life. And that's when I chose to turn it around. Finally, I made the choice at that point that my life was worth living and that I needed to change my internal circumstances. In order to change my internal circumstances, I had to change what I did every day. And so I cut out all the negativity. I changed all of my habits, and I reformed myself, you know, from my core, from the core of my being to, you know, the surface level of my skin in every way, mind, body, and spirit.
Now, there's a lot to unpack there, John. you know, one of the themes that comes through for me in the conversations I have on this show is that, you know, the whole premise of why I'm doing this is for us to make a change, right? And for us to understand that that begins with us, and that starts with our habits, you know? So right at the core of who you are, you changed your habits and you changed your life effectively.
100%. I say this all the time. Choose your habits, choose your life. Change your habits, change your life. My own coach says very frequently, show me a man's habits and I will predict his future. It's very clear when I see people, I mean, in this digital space or just in the physical firmament, it's very clear what their habits are. Thus, you can tell very, very quickly what their future is going to be, and you can tell what their past has been, what they haven't resolved within themselves. And yeah, people often want to make it very complicated, but just comes down to what we do every day. And if we do positive things every day, if our habits are good, then our future will be good. If we do negative things every day, if our habits are poor, then our future will be poor. It's as simple as that.
And you know, there's so many of us that go through life on autopilot, completely unaware of the habits that we have, and we think, oh, I can't help it, it's just who I am. You know, you have a choice. You absolutely have a choice. A choice in what you do, how you live your life, what you put in your mouth, how you spend your money, all of those kind of things are all habit-based and value-based decisions.
I love that. It's just who I am. If that isn't the most victim statement I've ever heard, it takes any power we have over our own lives and puts it elsewhere, even in focusing the lens on ourselves and saying it's just who I am. That is such a false notion. Who you are is comprised of what was done for you and what you have done for yourself. That's who you are. You are not, I mean, that just speaks to the robotic nature of our existence. And I'm down to get into that. You know, I live in New York City. This is one of the most, people want to say a lot of things about New York City. And as a native New Yorker, someone who's born and raised in New York City and now resides in New York City and will live here till the end of his days, I just bought a place. I bought this place. I can tell you that New York is a city. You know, there's a lot of robotic activity that goes on just on the street level. And that's part of Western culture. That's part of American culture. It's part of the dominant global culture that we just go through life through these rote motions. It robs us of any agency. That's just who I am is probably something I would have said a few years ago. Well, I'm very overweight. I think I was clinically obese at the time. Well, I'm clinically obese. That's just who I am. Well, I have massive issues around anxiety and depression. That's just who I am. I hate that phrase, and I love that you brought it up.
Yeah, and you know, I hear it very often, and I, you know, I went to LA last year, and I just saw people just going through the motions of life. They're like, they're living a life, but they're not actually in it. And I think, you know, that's what you're talking about as well, is this robotic life that we go through. It's just days and days just disappear, and we don't know what happened to them, you know? And that is sad.
It's completely soulless.
Yeah.
Excuse me. But it is completely soulless, and I'm not afraid to speak on it. We have been imbued by the Creator with a soul. It's simply, if you ever feel a connection with another person, that connection is not based, it is not a simple animal connection. That is a connection based on what we have inside. And we deny that when we do things to ourselves and with ourselves that run counter to any sort of positivity. The robotic idea that you are to sit in this area and go through the motions and take their drugs and eat their food and drink their liquor and go to their clubs and engage in their lifestyle is totally soulless and it's robotic. We might as well be automatons. We might as well be beings that say, that's just the way I am.
Yeah. Now, John, you've had so many things that have happened in your life that most people would be like, you know what, this, I'm done. I am just done. And you know, you are saying that, you know, you reached a point where you weren't sure you wanted to live anymore. I mean, how did you get out of that, and what made you want to go that far?
I'll answer the second question first. I mean, by the end of it, I was sleeping with people whose names I barely knew. I was using drugs that I should not have been using. I was drinking multiple times a week, and I was overeating every meal. I would overeat every meal. I was seeking pleasure because I didn't want to face my pain. And this short-term pleasure provides you with 10 minutes to 60 minutes of masking of escape, and then 10 hours to 60 hours of the come down. You know, every high is an equal low. I would say every high has a double low, and I've gotten higher than the Goodyear blimp. I mean, I've been so high I would take acid and be up for 1 or 2 days. I mean, I took acid for 2 weeks in the desert, not back to back, but there's this degenerate festival called Burning Man. I assume you've heard of it.
Yep.
And it's just about escaping. Excuse me. And yeah, I mean, to answer your question, just loop back for a sec. I engaged in so many negative acts that the karmic debt was choking me. I mean, it was literally killing me, the amount of karmic debt I had accrued in my life and then multiplied through this late stage period of hedonism and attempted escapism, that the pain of dealing with what I was doing, the pain of regret, was enough to drive me to the edge. You know, that's how far I had driven myself, that I put myself in that position. Nobody put me there but me. Nobody made me eat that. Nobody made me drink that. Nobody made me smoke that. Nobody made me use those dating apps or sleep with those people. Nobody made me curse the people that I knew because I was in this situation, or I was blaming my ex, I was blaming my family. It was just a victim mentality, blame game bullshit. And when I finally escaped, I found a coach who had come from a similar place of darkness and not only had healed himself, but actually had a track record of healing others, of getting other people in shape, of getting other people's minds and bodies right. And he had the blueprint for me. I simply followed I joined his team. I hired him. I followed the blueprint and the weight started coming off. Then the spiritual weight started coming off. Then the psychological weight started coming off. Then I wrote my ex a 5-page missive and called her up, and we sat down in the park and I read it to her, you know, crying, sobbing, you know, trying to absolve myself, successfully absolving myself of the debt I had accrued during and following our relationship. You know, I began to forgive myself. You know, the main burden that people hold on to is they're unable to forgive other people. But you can't forgive other people if you are engaging in unforgivable acts. You have to stop engaging those acts. The karmic debt will naturally decrease over time. And after you've cleared your own debts to yourself, you can only then forgive other people. I couldn't forgive other people for what I believe they had done to me, or they had actually done it for me, until I forgave myself. And I couldn't forgive myself until I stopped engaging in nihilistic, self-destructive things. Coach gave me a program of physical development, daily physical exercise. I had never worked out a day in my life. He gave me a program of intentional nutrition, which is by far the most important part of my coaching program. It's why it's food-based coaching. And he gave me mindset tactics. He gave me ways of thinking about myself and my life that reformulated everything from a negative to a test placed in front of me to make me stronger. That's mindset training, is looking at something that the average person would say as bad and knowing that it is good.
Mm. And, you know, getting to the mindset of it, you know, I talk to so many coaches and in particular fitness coaches as well. And we all know that it's the transformation inside that has to happen before the external transformation can happen. So, you know, understanding you found your pain, like, tell us what it was like when you actually got in touch with the pain that you were masking all that time, and once you managed to heal it and let it go.
Make summer more delicious with Whole Foods Market, where there's something for every adventure. Get ready for road trips with wallet-happy snacks, sparkling waters, and sports drinks from 365 by Whole Foods Market. Taking a staycation? Make it count with wild-caught fresh sockeye salmon, beef kebabs, and sirloin steaks for the grill, plus sweet and juicy summer fruit like sugar-kissed melons and organic cantaloupes. Don't forget fruit-filled pies for dessert. Summer your way with Whole Foods Market.
There was a period of minimum 2 months, but it may have been slightly longer, where I was in tears every morning during my workout. So I wake up very early for a lot of reasons, but the service level one, the one that one starts with, is to have enough time to get everything done. Mm-hmm. Very quickly, you realize that waking up early is showing gratitude to the universe. It's why I won't sleep in. It's why I continue to get up every morning at 4 a.m., you know, even though I am in shape and I do have enough time and I have a place to work out, and, you know, I have this place you see to work out in, or I could go to the gym or whatever. But I was getting up early for the first time in my life without being forced to. And in being, enforcing oneself to live an honest life, you have to be honest about your past. So the faces of, I'll be honest, the faces of people I had mistreated, ex-girlfriends, the people I had disrespected in my romantic and personal life, would begin to flash through my head. You know, it was my own past, my karmic debt was calling out to me. And I would begin to cry. I would be in my intense workouts in moderate to intense physical pain from working out. And then I would be in this deep emotional and spiritual pain. And the two fused. Mm. So the internal change of purging myself of this karmic debt fused with the external change of ridding myself of the excess body fat and body image and body negativity that I had carried. And the two became one. The two are one. If you look at a very unfit person, they are carrying an equal amount of emotional and spiritual weight. The two are the same. If you look at an extremely fit person, they likely had that weight. Like, extreme people in any way, you don't just become extreme. You are forced to that extremity from this extremity. If a professional athlete is so obsessive and neurotic about their training, they have to be about their nutrition. It's the same thing. If you want extreme success, you likely have had extreme failure in the past, or have done an extreme amount of positive things to ensure that you aren't failing. And I was doing an extreme amount of positive things, and it purged. It's like purging. It's like cleansing a wound. It's like putting antibiotic on a wound. There's that burning thing. The wound is festering and you finally cleanse it, but there's some pain there. But it was the most beautiful pain I ever experienced. I mean, I felt the weight of my infidelity lifting. I felt the weight of my drug use lifting. I felt the call to use substances lifting. And I haven't touched anything since the first day I started programming. I have not had a sip of alcohol. I have not touched any drugs, no weed, none of that, no cigarettes, nothing. I have refused to disrespect anyone in a personal or romantic sense. And I just, once you experience the pain of awareness, which is the pain that I'm in, when I walk down the street and I see someone quite overweight and I know how difficult it is for them to be at the beach or be around their family, or I walk down the street and I see someone muttering to themselves and I know that they're replaying some thought pattern in their mind. Once you are aware of other people's pain, that's the pain of awareness. The pain of regret would be unbearable. It would be unbearable. If I used drugs once, that you would not hear from me again. Mm. I would be in such a regretful state. I would be so deep in the pit from one break of character to that degree. I mean, it's not even something I could even conceive of using drugs again or drinking alcohol again. It doesn't even call to me. But that's the pain that we trade. The pain we get from our workout and coming to terms with our past and present supplants the pain of regret, of waking up hungover, of narcotized and all that nonsense.
And, you know, you were talking about forgiveness before. How did you find a way to forgive yourself and accept yourself for who you are now?
Like I said, I had to stop doing unforgivable acts. The standard human is going to be able to accept themselves. So let's just go back in time a bit. When we were in a pre-modern time, there was no self-rejection unless one committed what was very clearly a sin. You, that was not your wife. You were with your neighbor's wife. You are going to be killed for this. Like, this is a sin before God in the community. There's a massive price to pay. But now we can sneak around and do all types of weird stuff. We can eat whatever we want. We can do all of these things, and there's no real punishment. So it's a lot easier to accrue these negative things, to do these harmful acts. And it's also, people are easy, or they believe it's easy to accept themselves after doing that. There's a lot of acceptance around polyamory and a lot of other stuff that is inherently negative and obviously morally negative, but people believe they can accept themselves. But then they have this mental illness because they're trying to accept something that we have evolved to a genetic level, not a religious level, but on a genetic level to not do these things. If you were extremely out of shape back in the day, you would be left behind. You would die. You would not be able to produce for the group. And so when I was extremely out of shape, I wouldn't be able to tie my shoes. So let's say I had some role to play. There was some hunt to be done or some blanket to be woven or some physical exercise in order to keep the group alive. Well, I wouldn't be able to follow through, and I would have been rejected from the group. No wonder I was rejecting myself. So I had to stop doing rejection-based activities, with the rejection of self through drug use, through overeating, the rejection of self through self-hatred. We're rejecting our own self in doing that. And then we wonder, or I used to wonder, hey, why do I feel rejected by the group? Why do I feel rejected by society? Why do I feel rejected by my life? Well, you're doing all this negative stuff. You should be rejected. So you cut the negative stuff and your life will naturally align itself towards acceptance. Then you begin to accept yourself. You look at yourself in the mirror. Wow, I accept the individual staring back at me. It doesn't negate our past. We come to terms with it. Our past is there. We are no longer doing it. The most evolved man or woman or person, however you identify, the most evolved person is a person able to say, I was this. It was bad. Mm. I am this now. It is no longer bad. That's maturity. The weak individual will never say that they did anything wrong. It's always someone else's fault. It's just the way they are. They had to do that. And they just don't accept themselves. The best person, the people that I love, they say, oh, yeah, I used to do all that. Oh, man, that person was a loser. That guy was a freaking weirdo. He collapsed at the club on mushrooms, which happened to me more than once. Like, he used to be creeping on our girlfriends. I used to do that on the regular. That dude sucks. I'm not that dude anymore. That's the mature individual. That's the individual that accepts themselves. The liar says, oh, I'm cool with who I am, healthy at any size, which is psychotic. Or I can stop anytime I want to. It's okay to have a drink with the boy. None of these things are okay. They are not okay. I don't accept that, but I accept myself as I am now because I'm walking in line with my conscience.
Mm, absolutely. And it reminds me of a phrase that I came up with years ago, and it's all about nourishment, not punishment. Because, you know, we are either our greatest advocate or our greatest enemy. And it just depends what side of the fence you're on, you know?
That is so accurate. Seneca wrote that we suffer far more in imagination than reality. Mm. And that and if the reality is constructed by the group at large, right, then what is constructing our imagination? That's ourselves. We are absolutely our own harshest critic, our own greatest ally, our own greatest enemy. Nobody made me eat a quarter ounce of mushrooms, blow a bunch of lines, and go to the club looking for someone's girlfriend or wife to hook up with. No one made me do that. And then nobody made me the next day have the worst anxiety attack. I would be, Bindi, I would be bedridden, stricken in bed with anxiety and panic attack. What did you do last night? And then it would be, you are so hungover and messed up. You know you have all these things to do today. And then I wouldn't do the things. So I had destroyed myself last night and I couldn't do the responsible man things today. Is it any wonder that I hated myself? Mm. I didn't have social media. Like, I love human connection is fabulous. It's what I live for. I did not have social media. Now social media is a massive part of who I am. I post every day. It's how I find almost all of my clients. Some I met in the physical firmament in New York just because my other projects I'm involved in, I do come in contact with a lot of people and they knew me before. But I was so ashamed of myself. I was so afraid of being judged and caring what other people thought and this bizarre neurotic obsession about how other people would perceive me, as if I need to give a damn about how other, like, the worst thing was how I perceived myself, yet I cared so much more outwardly about how other people perceived me, and I didn't really care about how I perceived myself at all. I didn't perceive myself well, but I put no focus on how I could perceive myself better. It was only about how other people could perceive me. So yeah, it just, that's how we accept ourselves, by bringing ourselves to a place of acceptance, self-acceptance.
Now, Jon, if someone's listening to this and they're hearing about your journey and your story and they're going, this dude is speaking my story. And if they're struggling right now and they're having trouble with, you know, their nutrition or, you know, substance abuse, whatever it might be, or even if mentally they're in a place where I just can't do it anymore, what advice would you have for them right now?
No state is permanent except for the state of death. And that is the state I was placed in your life to stop you from entering. No matter what you are going through, someone has gotten through it or worse. There have been billions of people that have perished before you, and some of them were dealing with what you dealt with and did not choose to hurt themselves. They did not choose to drown themselves in temporary pleasure. They did not choose to take the quick way out. They chose life, and you can as well. I had all the problems. I resented my family for the burden. I was so resentful of everyone. I even cursed my own genetic composition. I cursed people in my past. I cursed all of my exes. It was everybody else's fault. I was a non-believer. I believed in nothing other than my own pain, and I believed my own pain to be the worst pain ever known. I was totally self-centered. I was totally lost. I was using all the same things you are, and it is possible to escape. In fact, if you have a substance abuse problem, if you have an obsessive thought problem, if you have any of these issues, it actually posits you as a better candidate for healing. The most committed people I know are addicts of some type. And the most positive people are obsessive people. They're just a typical obsessed person is going to be obsessed with negativity. I was a negativity addict. I was obsessed with it. So once I learned a mindset reframe and this program that I work and live every day, I just took all the negative stuff I was doing and turned it to positive. I took all of the resentments and turned it to understanding that these people went through pain. Any pain that you experience from other people is an externalization of pain that they internalized. No unhurt person is going to lash out at you. No non-judged person is going to judge you unfairly. What you are feeling, what you are going through, the pain that other people have gifted you is an externalization of their pain. Your parents were not there for you because their parents were not there for them. Does that mean you shouldn't be there for you? Does that mean you shouldn't be there for your kids and your people? Absolutely not. Change starts with you, change starts with us, and change starts with you getting in touch with me because I have walked that path. I know how dark it can get. And I want to ensure that you don't come as close as I did to making the wrong choice.
Guys, if you can't see Jon, he is fired up. and he's the guy you want on your side if you want to try and turn things around, obviously. He's managed to do it for himself. He's living proof of it. Now, Jon, did I read that you also are doing some stuff around food rescue?
100%. It's something I've always been interested in. I've been rescuing food since 2009, my first service industry job in New Orleans. I would take trays of bread to homeless encampments under the overpass in New Orleans where I was living. And I've always found it extremely unjust for us to waste food while people are hungry. But my capacity to rescue food was limited by my capacity to essentially rescue myself. So all of my food projects and food rescue projects, and there have been a lot since 2009, have been good, but until I really got my own mind and body in check, I couldn't really take it to the next level. And over the last couple of years, I and some comrades set up a food rescue network in New York City, picking up at its peak a couple dozen locations every day, and we're feeding about 7,000 families per week. This is all food that was edible but unsaleable. This is not dumpster diving. This is perfectly good food. Let's say a loaf of bread has an expiration date, which is laughable, of Monday. The store needs to pull it off the shelves by Friday for capitalist reasons. And thus, it isn't even past its sell-by date. It just can't be sold. It's unsaleable. So the network I set up would rescue that and everything else. And it has been a massive lesson on this path because my capacity to rescue food has marched in lockstep with my capacity to love myself. Back when I didn't really love myself, I could only do it to a certain degree. And as that love grew, my love for others grows. And there's nothing more loving than rescuing stuff that would hit the dumpster and hit the landfill and giving it to people who are going hungry. There are over a million New Yorkers that went hungry last year. This is absurd. There are 8 million people in the city. 1.1 million went hungry last year. At the same time, in the U.S., this country throws out one third of all food grown. So this is a massive issue. This is a fundamental issue of ecology, of psychology. I believe a massive problem that we have with our bodies and our food is related to the way it's treated. We have all-you-can-eat buffets, and we're wasting a third of the food. It's total mind-body-spirit sickness. It's no wonder our Mother Earth hates us, wouldn't you? Mm. If you gave a group of people all they needed to live, and they threw out a third of it and turned the other two-thirds into mainly a garbage stream, it's horribly disrespectful. And I appreciate you asking about the Food Rescue Project, because it's a massive part of who I am and what I do.
And, you know, it's funny. I've had a lot of conversations with a lot of health experts as well, particularly around nutrition. And, you know, the US in particular is probably one of the fattest starving nations we know. Because, right. And you know, and you've said it right there, is that it's the mindset around the resources. Because, you know, you look at other countries like, say, India, or even in Indonesia and certain places, where they actually honor their food, they honor and they treat it with respect, you know. And, you know, Western society, we just are such a instant throwaway society. We don't take any, you know, respect when it comes to the food. Like there's so many levels we could go into. We could do a whole podcast just on this alone. But it's just,
sign me up.
Like, it's just something that we're robots about, you know, like we're just not aware and conscious of what we're putting in our bodies and what we're spending our money on, and then how we're then dealing with waste.
It's absurd. And the most absurd thing is what people will spend their money on with food and what they won't spend their money on. Mm. Supporting farmers in the contemporary discourse is considered a bourgeois luxury to go to the farmer's market and to buy your food directly at a real wage from farmers. The way the market is set up, it is very expensive and not everybody can afford it. But the amount of subsidies given to large agribusiness companies and the large soy and corn and soybean growers in this country could easily be shifted. Those subsidies could be shifted to small farmers. They could be shifted to setting up farmers markets in every city, town, and village in the U.S. They could be shifted to creating dollar match programs where every dollar spent actually gets you $2. The amount, it's about resource distribution. The resources are there. Mm. We were an agrarian economy. Everyone grew their own food. And during wartime and World War II, there was a government mandate that people had to grow victory gardens. And they had, you know, it's only in times of war that we actually treat the earth as it should be. In times of peace, we're declaring war on the earth, and it's sickening. If supporting your local farmer is too expensive, then we have a serious problem, because what we're doing is essentially poisoning ourselves at the expense of the small local farmers. Well, I can't afford that. Okay, well, what can you afford, and why? Why is it set up that only rich people can shop at farmers markets? It's all intentional. If there is an intentional thing to pump as much. So food, a lot of food these days is not actually considered food. If you read The Omnivore's Dilemma by Michael Pollan, he goes into this. A lot of it cannot be labeled food. It has to be labeled food product. And in being labeled food product, you can then infuse it with as many corn and soybean derivatives as possible. And in doing so, it increases the amount of corn and soybeans grown, and it decreases the nutritive value of all the garbage that is pumped into our bloodstreams. I mean, it is sickening. I will not eat their garbage. I won't. I mean, I did for a long time. Dude, that dude in the before photo, he loved to eat that garbage. He was at the trough. All you can eat sushi, sign me up, buffet, breakfast, lunch, dinner, find me at brunch, probably boozing. Like, that dude was lost. And at the same time, I was into local food and I was doing a little bit of food rescue. Like, that's cognitive dissonance. That's another thing that our system does so well. It allows us to believe two contradictory thoughts at the same time. You have ads for Lexapro, and then you have ads for alcohol. So they're both okay, even though they do the same thing. Like, I would engage in these dissonant behaviors, such as saying I liked to support local and saying I like to engage in food rescue. And I did, but then I would go and do a bunch of other negative behaviors that limited my capacity to the positive ones. And I wondered why I woke up extremely depressed. Mental illness comes from the tension between what we do and what we think. As soon as we resolve that tension and we think that, hey, I actually would like to be with one person for the rest of my life, like, you know, I've been genetically hardwired to do forever, And then we line that up with, hey, I'm not going to chase meaningless hookups and engaging and getting as close to another person as I can and treating them like the food that I waste every day. Oh, wow, I'm not depressed and anxious anymore. I don't hate my body anymore. I'm not using other people's bodies anymore. It's crazy how that works.
Yeah, man, it's just, it blows my mind how everything is flipped, you know, like how, like you were saying, it's so expensive just to support a farmer. Like when I grew up in rural farming communities here in southeast Queensland, and as a teenager I worked on farms. I would be working on potato harvesters and packing carrots and all kinds of things, and those farms are now gone. Like 30 years later, they are gone. This is ridiculous. Like, these were thriving communities that were doing well. Now those people, they're gone. All of what they worked for is gone.
This episode is brought to you by Certified Piedmontese Beef. Listen up, foodies. Make your next meal even better with real Nebraska beef. They have healthy, tender, delicious Italian heritage beef, grass-fed and sustainably raised on lush pastures in the Midwest. You can even create your own personally curated meat box that's shipped right to your door. To get two free steaks with any purchase over $50, use the code FREEBEEF at checkout. Learn more and shop exclusively at cpbeef.com.
Yeah, from what I understand, and obviously understand a million times more than I do, but from my limited understanding, Australia has one of the worst problems. The worst problems, ecological problems, food problems, and yeah, the small farms dying out. I'm sure there's a growing amount of food that's being imported, which is shocking considering if small growers were empowered, Australia has enough arid land. There is enough land to grow, but it boggles the mind. And I care less about it from a rescue perspective than I do from a self-destructive perspective. People are not going to stop self-destructing until they stop wasting food. People are not going to stop self-destructing until they start eating intentionally. When I think more than 50% or about 50% of Americans are either overweight or obese, I think it might be more than 50%, we have a serious issue. Like, that is a serious issue. People love to talk about fat shaming and body shaming. I will tell you all exactly what fat shaming is. Fat shaming is what I felt when I was fat. When I was fat and I looked in the mirror, I felt extremely ashamed, not only because of the way I looked, because what it takes. In order to look, to feel ashamed, you have to take shameful actions. That's where shame comes from. We're not naturally ashamed of something we shouldn't be ashamed of. We're ashamed from doing shameful stuff. Mm. You are ashamed of stuff that brings you shame. So that's what fat shame is. Fat shame is what I felt. Body shame is what I felt. Nobody did that to me. I did all that to myself. And the lie these days that these things come from external sources is so false. It is so false. There is nothing healthy about being a certain size. It is literally a death sentence. It is not possible to be healthy at any size. These are extremely toxic. This language is extremely toxic and is becoming normalized. I've said this before. There's a difference between normal and normalized. What has been normalized is not normal. It is extremely abnormal. I was extremely abnormal in the fact that I was clinically obese, depressed, and anxious. Now it's been normalized. Everyone I know is one, two, or three of them. And I guarantee you, every person watching this knows someone, or most people in the world, unless they have actively worked to heal themselves of this, which is what I do every day. And don't get me wrong, healing is a process. It's not a product. You're not just healed. If I were to sleep in tomorrow and not work out and not eat right, I would feel awful. So let's get that straight. But the reason people are so messed up is because these activities have been normalized. On the New York City subway, there are ads for the most degenerate stuff that is soul destroying, stuff that made me nihilistic, hookup apps, various things related to sex and hooking up, massive amounts of food things. These are vices. These are addictions. They're extremely profitable and they drive us towards self-destruction. So that's what fat shaming is. It's being ashamed of being fat. It's nothing else. And anyone that says otherwise either has been in shape their whole life or has never been not fat. Mm. It's only the person that has been both that is qualified to speak on these types of things.
Mm. There's a lot to unpack there too. But, you know, I want to go back to something you were talking about before. And that was, you know, like when we get back to, you know, I like to compare ourselves to cavemen. And it's something I love to do in a whole type of different situations in society. And this is a perfect one. And you were mentioning it before. So, you know, let's say, you know, back in the evolution, cavemen didn't have these issues that we have today. They didn't have the drugs. They didn't have the processed food. They didn't have alcohol. And they basically were living a life of survival. Compare it to today. I always like to look, put a lens on it, that if the cavemen of yesterday could see us today, they would just be absolutely boggled by what we've done to ourselves.
It's shocking. All of our problems are environmental. In the pre-modern era, one spent their time in action. You were occupied all day, every day. You had to gather, you had to forage, you had to hunt. Hey, if you were extremely creative, you best believe you were writing music. If you are good in the kitchen, best believe that you are cooking. Back in the day, I would have been in the garden, gardening, which is what I'm good at. And I would have been doing something creative because I'm a creative individual. So I would have been doing that all day. Now, since we've been robbed of a lot of the best things, we have to find meaning in something. One of the defining features of our system, of society, of what you and I are expected to do, is to have a serious lack of meaning. So when you have, when everything has been deracinated and denatured, you find meaning anywhere you can. So I'll find meaning in this escape. I'll find meaning in this thing. Back in the day, caveman or otherwise, you were engaged in activity. It was a struggle to survive. That's where animal sacrifice came from. Animal sacrifice came from, I have this thing I need to survive. I'm going to sacrifice this thing, this food sacrifice that I need to survive, so I get blessings. Like that's how real it was. That's why they killed an animal. They needed that thing. They didn't know if they were going to survive the winter or not. So no, we're going to give this to Creator and hope that we're duly blessed in return. We don't have any of that. 100 feet from where I sit now, there are probably 3 weed dispensaries, 10 restaurants, and 5 bodegas for me to destroy my life in. All of them are going to destroy it. And not all restaurants are inherently negative, but the manner in which they're presented to us as this cornucopia of food is totally false. We, our ancestors, the cavemen, let's say, for lack of a better word, pre-modern, actually like cavemen, our ancestors, they didn't have all the access to what we have. And what they did have access to, they were extremely grateful for. We don't have the gratitude, but we do have the access. And it's horrible. We just need, people need a positive structure, a mission, a plan, a process to adhere to. And thankfully, I found this system and this process, or else I'd be lost in the netherworld doing God knows what.
Man, I could talk to you all day, John. There's a million things we could go through here, and so many rabbit holes I could go down. But look, I know that so many people could get great value by chatting to you. So if people want to get in touch with you and find out more, where can they go?
At NYC Foodways on Instagram. You can find me there. Most of my clients get in touch with me there. I post every day. There's lots of mindset tips, hacks. The vast majority, I encourage everyone to visit my page to absorb as much of the info as possible. I break down what I do every day in my stories. My reels and posts are more mindset-based. And please take as much information, gain as much value, absorb as much wisdom as possible from that. If you're interested in a more tailored approach, someone to break down your macros, your macronutrient structure, your nutrition plan, someone to provide you with a lot of custom stuff, workout routines, you're more than welcome to reach out to me, hop on the team. And I have 2 coaching programs. I have a one-on-one where you learn everything I know about mindset, fitness, nutrition, training, how to drop resentments against your family, how to love yourself, and then a group program where you learn the same thing in a group setting. There's so much content that I'm putting out. I need you all to change, whether or not you join me on this journey in a closer economic sense or not. I need the message of positivity and change to be spread. I'd be lying. I would be lying to the world if I didn't share how to heal the deepest wounds known to our species. Anxiety, depression, obesity, resentments are the 4 deepest wounds our species know. And if I had the tools to heal those and didn't share them far and wide, I would be the most selfish man in existence. So please visit the page, check out what I do every day, and you will learn very quickly how to elevate yourself out of the pit.
And John, I know there was a reason you and I found each other, because we're on the exact same mission. And so with that, I have my last final question for you. What's the change you'd like to see in the world, and how can we bring it to light?
Men need to become responsible. That is the biggest thing. I see too many men from my past, present, and hopefully not my future that have abdicated their responsibility. They have sided with themselves and their own base pleasure and what society would tell them is okay, instead of siding with their conscience and what their people need from them. And that's what I want to see. I want to see, most of the people I coach are men. And as a man, I'm more comfortable speaking on men. I'm not super interested in speaking on other folks. I want to see others acknowledge the pain that they have caused people in their lives by being weak. As soon as you acknowledge the fact that you were weak and potentially are weak and are willing to change, we will create strong, responsible individuals to help guide others towards a more positive future by first guiding ourselves. That's the change I want to see in the world.
Oh, I love it. I love it. Thank you so much. And I have loved every second with you, John. Thank you so much for being a part of the Ethical Evolution.
You are so welcome. I'll see you for round two. We talk only food rescue.
Oh, I think we're going to be back with more. Thanks for listening to the Ethical Evolution podcast. If you're ready to be the change and would love to work with me on finding your voice through spiritual coaching or creating your own podcast with impact, visit ethicalchangeagency.com. There's a change happening in the way we live, the way we work, the way we spend our money and make our decisions. We are evolving to be more conscious in our actions in a way that serves the world and makes it a better place. Welcome to the Ethical Evolution. The mission is simple: to spread stories of collective change that make the world a better place, understanding that to create collective change, we need to be the change. It all begins with us.
Electricast Records presents Jeff Simons and his brand new single, 48 Lines About 12 Men.
Johnny was a kid who grew up in Scituate. He had a million one-liners and a problem with barbiturates. He's a bartender and a bartender's son. His race was over before it even begun.
Jeff Simons, 48 Lines on Electricast. Punk and Roll for 2023.
Electricast.